Good morning. I'd like to welcome everybody out to our class this morning. We finally finished the book of Ephesians, and it was bittersweet. I think it was more bitter than sweet because it's such a beautiful book, and it's so informative, and I really get uplifted by the thoughts of the book of Ephesians. But that brings us now to the opportunity that we have this morning to break into the book of Colossians. And I'm really excited for this because I have not taught the book of Colossians as I've taught from it. I've preached from it, but I haven't actually taught it like we do here in this environment. So I'm very excited about it. The focus, I think, of the book of Colossians is really the superiorities of Jesus Christ. There's a lot of other things in there, but it's the superiorities of Jesus Christ as really an answer to false teachings or false doctrines about Christ, you know, about anything that has to do with what God had done through Christ Jesus. And so a lot of false teachings come into the church or came into the early churches, you know, like for Galatians, for example, might have had to do with legalism. And so to combat that, you know, obviously the superiorities of Jesus Christ and what he accomplished himself for our sakes is the solution or the remedy to those false teachings. And that's why it's important to know the truth. That's why it's important to have these things in your knowledge base and a commanding understanding of them so that those false teachings won't cause you to wobble when faced with them. I was online this week and a girl had posted a little video on social media, and she was crying because she was struggling to know that she had salvation and trying to have the salvation experience. And that just kind of got to me, and I started in like, hey, I can help you with that. But there's people that are struggling because they're not getting the whole truth, or they're being taught something that's a fallacy or a heresy or a non-truth, and they're struggling as a result. These kind of things that have been recorded for us in the book of Colossians and other books in the Bible, God has put there to help anchor us so that we don't have to live those torn up lives, and we can live the life that he really intended for us in salvation, and that is peaceful, joyful, and secure. And add any of the other words to that you want to add. Love, loving, you know, all those things. And if we're caught chasing our tail on false teachings, we're not going to experience the love, the joy, the peace, the confidence and security that God has really intended for us for our lives as a result of what Christ has done. So that's, man, I feel like, okay, class is over. No, but we're going to go to Lord in word prayer at this time, and then we're going to jump into this introduction for the book of Colossians. Gracious Holy Father, we come before you, Lord, grateful for this day that you've made, for the life that you've given each one of us, for the mercy that you show us, whose mercies are endless and constant. Father, it's so heavy on the heart sometimes, the things that we have to constantly be repenting for, and the realization of the lack of strength sometimes that we display in resisting the sin that we are faced with. But Father, we know that Christ's blood covers us, but that's not an excuse. And we pray, Father, that while we might find peace in the blood of Jesus Christ for our sinfulness, we ask, Father, that you'll give us the strength to overcome, to resist, to get better, and Lord, to strive to put things aside in our life that become stumbling blocks for us and others, and help us to be a people that reflects Christ in the things he said and done and does do. And Lord, I know that these verses we're going to be looking at through the course of this study are going to help reveal that to us, and the urgency and the need to do so. And so we pray that you enlighten our and bless our study, that you help us to grow in the truth, the knowledge and wisdom of your word. And we pray, Father, that you will magnify it in such a way that we are touched by it, that it anchors our life, that it's things that are revealed to us that we will not forget, that you will call to our memory when we face situations or opportunities to trespass your will for our lives. Father, we ask that you will Bless me as I teach. I pray that you might give me the grace I stand in desperately in need of, that your spirit will have full course in this lesson, that your spirit will take control of all things so that the power might be in the spirit as your word goes out. I pray that the spirit might take it to each hearer, Lord, one who endeavors to listen on to these things, that they will be touched in the way that the spirit so choose, knowing their life fully and intimately. Please, Father, I pray that you'll bless our pastor as he brings his message that you have laid upon his heart that he's engaged in even now in prayer, I'm sure, and in thought. And Father, I pray that you'll bless us to receive it. Please bless this church and her ministry. I pray that you'll save souls today. I pray that you'll change lives for your honor and glory, for your praise, Father, that those lives might be forever a light in the world as well. And Father, I ask these favors and blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so the reason for the picture, when I was looking over the book of Colossians and I was thinking, okay, what would be a suitable picture? The reason I picked this picture, because it really is the work that Jesus did for us that makes it possible for us to overcome. So when we talk about the superiorities of Jesus Christ, certainly God taking on the form of a man, coming to this earth, living, teaching, saving souls, healing people, changing lives, yet being placed on a cross innocently for no reason whatsoever because they didn't like his truth, and crucified for the sin of humanity, willfully laying down his life on the cross of Calvary, being placed in a grave and arising from that grave in life because the grave had no power over him, is the reason that we can breathe, that we can have, and when I say breathe, literally, I'm talking about the type of relationship we can have with God, whereby we can put the sins that we've committed before God, ask him for forgiveness of them, and then ask him to come into our heart and life and save us and find freedom so that we might breathe and have our being apart from the condemnation of sin. And so that's why I selected this, because you'll find when we get in the book of Colossians, the superiorities of Christ, there's some of the most lofty things the apostle says. I almost said who it was, but we're going to get into that. The apostle says with regards to Jesus Christ, and they're beautiful. They're beautiful things. And it was some of those things that we actually touched on in the book of Ephesians that I brought into to make a point on some other areas in the book of Ephesians that really started to convict me about this being our next study. So it hit me literally quickly when I started to read over those things in Colossians. And then when I went back and read the whole book, which, by the way, 4 chapters, so it's really easy to read. You can do it in a very short period of time. Matter of fact, if you got the Bible app, it'll narrate it for you, and you'll be done in 20, 30 minutes. So please do that and give yourself a head start. But I'm going to jump into the introduction. So what we should have done with Ephesians, but we didn't, but I think we got to it through the course of the study of the book of Ephesians. We're going to do it now here this morning, and that is what I got on here on the screen. It says, it is necessary when entering a study of the Bible scriptures to answer several important questions about the book or the epistle or whatever it is you're reading in the scriptures to help clarify the context and purpose, therefore establishing the impacts and takeaways. So we have some questions we want to start in this introduction to ask and learn about the book of Colossians. Now, I'm going to go on record right now and tell you this is not an exhaustive introduction. Because I know if I did an exhaustive, we'd probably be doing this for 3 weeks and before we even got into the verses, and I'd probably lose half of the listeners in that process. So there has to be some element that's left to the Bible student to go and explore. And so I'm going to give you a baseline, but you can go in and you can read about it more through research material and put some of these things into a greater picture for yourself, and I hope that you take the time to do that. So the first of these questions is, who was the writer? Okay, that's answered for us pretty quickly. And it I'm going to tell you before I put this up that when I was reading what commentators had to say about this subject, that there were some that were still on the fence as whether this person was actually the writer, when it's very obvious in the scriptures that he is. But here's the passage of scripture, Colossians chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. It says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ, which are at Colossae, depending how you want to pronounce that. And so we find here automatically that the writer is the Apostle Paul. And you will find that this is what most commentators and people that study, theologians that study the Bible, would tell you, that this was one of his prison epistles. So they place the writing of this at the time he was in prison in Rome. And so it's and I want to just jump ahead, but we'll get into that. He had a liberty there because God blessed him with a liberty in Rome. He had gained so much, I guess you would say, respect or trust from his imprisoners, that he was given a lot of liberty for a prisoner. They respected him. They trusted him. And he got a lot of privileges while he was waiting his appeal to Caesar. But anyways, this would be one of those epistles. And there's some interesting things I learned just in this first part of the study about the book that I'm going to share with you. So the writer is Apostle Paul, and this is one of them, that it would appear that he had not personally been to this church. So I know that he, in his missionary journeys, moved in and throughout the region that is known this actual location, I'm going to show you a map in a minute, is Turkey today. So where this city is in what we call Turkey today. And I know that Paul's missionary journeys, the first one led him up, you know, Perugia and places that were very close to this, but it appears that he had not actually been to this church and actually seen these people face to face. And here's what most base that off of. Okay, here's the first one, Colossians 1, 3, and 4. It says, we give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love which ye have to all the saints. For that's the first thing. The thing I also want to point out, because I want to bring you back to Ephesians now, and I want you to think about what we learned in Ephesians. I want you to keep that, because here's what, notice what he says, giving thanks to God. So you'll always see this man giving thanks to God. That's, and he's doing that through the form of prayer, praying, talking to God and praising him. It's part of the aspect of our prayer life. But he says, praying always for you. So here's a guy that's always got this prayerful attitude. We talked about, when we talked about the soldier's armor the last couple of weeks, and we talked about that one thing that we have, that one ability that we have to make ourselves successful. When I say make ourselves, to allow God to make us successful. I mean, if you're praying, you're making an effort to make yourself successful, because you're utilizing the avenue of prayer. Well, he already understood that. And that's why he is an advocate at pressing that thought, because prayer is the key to pulling everything into a successful endeavor. So he says, but notice he says, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus. And so now he's identifying that this is something he's hearing of from somebody. Colossians 2:1 said this, for I would that ye knew what great conflict I have for you and for them at Laodicea and for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh. Now, I'm just going to say that most theologians that write or study this and prepare thoughts on it hold that Paul had not been to this church. I'm not going to say definitively, because you can see here that he says, and for as many as have not seen my face. You could tie that to them, or you could say that that's those that hadn't seen him that were those later after he left. But generally speaking, based on what I've read and I've studied the book of Acts, I've taught it twice, verse by verse, and I say there's a good chance he had that the general thought that he had not been there personally plays out not only in the history of his missionary journeys in the book of Acts, but also in what we're going to find in here, because he does some things a little bit different in his writing than he might do, like, say, to the Ephesians. When he closed out the letter to the Ephesians, there was a couple little things that he said. He wanted to encourage them. He wanted prayer from them. He was praying for them. And we showed how he was one of those prayer warriors. He was one of those people that cared about the people at Ephesus. We knew he had been there. There wasn't as drawn out of an ending to the letter as you're going to find in the book of Colossians, where by it, and I'm going to move on here. I'm going to get this map up. By it, it would explain the warm and personal greeting at the end of the book. So he's got this long, a warm and personal greeting at the end of the book where he's introducing a lot of different people that are kind of helping him, fellow laborers that are doing things like, I think I've been pronouncing his name wrong, Tychicus. I'm just going to stick with it. Tychicus is how I tried so hard to get it right, but he's Tychicus to me. Oh. You'd say, hey, look, brother, as long as you're looking at me when you say it, I'm good. My grandma used to always call me Royce. She'd go, Royce? I wondered if she called my cousin Royce Scott. She'd go, Royce? And I'm like, Grandma, Royce ain't here. But she's looking right at me. I said, but I'll be Royce as long as you're looking at me. I'll be Royce for you. Interesting enough, we look alike. So that kind of played into it, I'm sure. Of course, she was 92. Strong as an ox too. Even at 92, she was quite the worker, that woman. But anyways, all right, getting back into this. So we had this long personal greeting at the end where he's really kind of showing them the team of people that help him to accomplish some of the things that he accomplishes from prison. And also, you know, those that would carry these letters that he writes to the places that he writes them to, of which this was one. Philemon might be another one, I think, that was carried at this time. And so you can see, there's something different kind of being done here at the end of the letter. When we get to it, you'll understand. Now, I got this map up here. I don't know if we can put it up, Jesse, but you'll see the big red spot right there. You can see in the lower corner where it shows the greater region of Turkey, Greece, and Italy above Africa and all that. But then you can also see in this map, you can see three very closely neighbored cities. You see Colossae, you see Laodicea, and you see Herodias. And so they were kind of a region of people. And I think that you'll hear Hierapolis. You'll hear make reference to those in the book as well. But you also notice Ephesus just straight over from there, right at the coast. So you can see there's a pretty good distance around there. I know Paul made his way through Ephesus on a couple occasions, missionary there, but then he also returned there on his way back to Jerusalem, I think following his third missionary journey. But anyways, I wanted to kind of show you the region, because I wanted you to have the closeness of Laodicea, Hierapolis, and Colossae, because they're mentioned in the scriptures. So you'll have this image in your head. All right. Now, I believe that he had a natural spiritual love for these believers, which had likely developed by that which he learned from Epaphras. And you know, it's like anything else. If you find out that there's a group of believers over here that's working really hard, you didn't even know, you would naturally feel warm about that and warm about them. And if you were to even learn about what they were doing, you, by the Spirit, you would feel this great connection to them, and you would be happy. It would make your heart happy. And then if you got the actual chance to dialogue with them, let's say there's someone out of country and you get the chance to even dialogue with them, then you would be even more uplifted. And we've had people from this church that are here today literally go to Romania and work in Bible studies and youth programs there for a couple weeks. We've had some from our sister churches do it multiple times, and or go to other countries, maybe South America and places like that, where we have missionaries working to participate in BBS? Vacation Bible School. Thank you. So they would have engagement in that and go down there and work and labor. And them people, they didn't even know. They just knew that they were there And they were working with the missionary families. And then when they get down there, they make these bonds and connections, because after all that, they finally were able to see them face to face, and it uplifts the spirit. I think that's what you're kind of seeing here, the same kind of thing. Although Paul also had an apostolic authority and an unction, I think, of the spirit that really gave him, his mission was so important to him that it poured out spiritually in the capacity of what you see here, to where he's just connecting automatically. He hears of a potential problem in the body, and he is connected to it, and he wants to address it. And so he had this natural spiritual love for these believers, which had likely developed by that which he learned from Epaphras. And we'll get into that. So this is just the introduction. So we're just kind of trying to wet the whistle here. He was looking to develop a warm, loving, personal connection with them in an effort to minister and serve them more effectively rather than just assert his apostolic authority. He could have been, it's like, I'm the apostle, this and this and this. But that wasn't, so we can just read that statement there and we can just say, okay, we're focusing now on Paul trying to connect with them. But what we should be seeing in it and in Paul's actions, if you learn from his actions, is the right way to go about connecting with people, so thereby you might be able to influence their life in a more positive way effectively. So instead of using a road that he could have utilized and it would have been right and it would have been respected by God, he chose to go with a great more amount of attention to trying to connect, to trying to really show his passion for that situation and their welfare. And what he was doing to try to mitigate these problems for their sakes. So that, I think you see, when you look at this letter as a whole, when you read through it, not only in the first chapter, but in the last. So he wanted to connect. He wanted to be able to minister and serve them more effectively. And as a result, you see that he's taken this warm, loving, personal effort to connect. And that should be a marker for us to place in our lives to say, hey, here's something we should look at. Whenever I get an email that has something from a customer that is important, I'll flag it. I'll put a big red flag on it because it's important. And I got to make sure that I do something with that, right? So this would be a good thing to flag, that we try to have this be our way. I pulled this picture. You're going to see one later that's kind of like it, but they're actually kind of, I believe, different, or just different spots on the same road. This is really one of the main roads. It was leading up, I believe, to a theater, but this is Kloss today in the image. And I like to look at stuff like this because it kind of gives you an idea of what it might have been like back at the time of this writing. There's not as many pictures. There's much more pictures of the bigger cities like Ephesus and stuff like that. But anyways, a lot of people do go to visit to see some of these ancient structures. Okay, so Chuck Swindoll comments on this subject that we're talking about. This is his comment on this subject of Paul reaching out to this church. He says, the more personal tone at the close of this letter would have been especially significant and creating a connection with the Colossian believers, given the fact that part of Paul's reason for writing involved calling out the heretical teachers who had infiltrated the Colossian church. So you see, he's trying to get to an endpoint, and the endpoint is really to solidify their position on Christ so that they're not torn apart or taken to and from by false teaching. So he's trying to solidify their place in Christ. And so to do that, he wanted to, like I said, he wanted to draw close to them. He wanted to develop a relationship and a rapport that they could trust, that they could see value in, that they could count then that the things that he was teaching them, they could put faith in. And so it was a good approach. It shows a loving approach. And I really think that that's something we can learn from. So the next question, to whom was the apostle writing? We've already answered this question in scripture. To the believers called saints and faithful brothers in Christ, which are at Colossae. That was the verse we read earlier. And so those were the people. Now, why is that important? Because when you understand this epistle, why, who he's writing to, and then ultimately why he's writing to them, you'll be able to see what is really being meant by this scripture. You can take a passage of scripture. You could go get a passage of scripture out of Colossians. You could just pull that guy up and you could read it and you could tell somebody, oh, this means that. But the minute you take that same passage of scripture and you put it into the right context, in other words, who wrote it? Who were they writing it to? When did they write it? What was the subject of the writing and what was the purpose of that writing? Then you can begin to see what it actually meant and how it is applied. And then you can say to yourself, where do I fit into that? Because you do fit in. Because false teaching is still prevalent in the world today concerning Christ. People are teaching a lot of false things about Christ, probably more so now because of social media. It's getting to be something that's worldwide spread from one place to another, and you don't even have to be there. You just got to have an app you can post it on. So there's a lot of things that's being said. It may be more applicable to us today than it was even them. So it's important that we grab the context, and that's what knowing these things is all about. To the believers called saints, the faithful brothers in Christ, which were at Colossae. So he's going to teach these believers and these faithful brothers in Christ, because, you know, you see in the front part of the book that they had some good things going for them. But you can have some good things going for you as a church, and some false teachers can creep in and just start tearing it up. And don't think the devil don't know to do that. Don't think he don't have his workers. He does. You've been in church for any given period of time, you're going to see him. you're going to see those. And so, but the way you combat it is this way. You begin to understand and know the truth. And believe me, it's not going to set well with the false teachers, but it's going to set well with the Lord. And I would rather it set well with the Lord. So, but not only that, you retain your relationship in with regard to the truth. When you do that, you retain it. And that's important. The truth wins. It's always the truth. You may not like it, but it's always the truth. And it always wins. Why? Because it's the truth. It's the way it is. But you know what? Truth is better than the false. Whoever enjoyed the results of the false? I mean, I'd like to know. If you did, they were temporary. They weren't lasting. Why? Because the false is false. You know, it's a counterfeit. It's okay. You want counterfeit money? You want counterfeit gold? I'm going to go get a piece of gold that's going to be gold plated, and it's going to weigh like gold. But when you melt it down, you're just going to get a bunch of lead. You're going to be upset if you paid gold price for that. Right? Okay. That's the point. I think we understand. So it's these believers, these faithful brothers and sisters in Christ were who he was addressing. People that needed to be anchored, that needed to know this. What was the date of the writing of the epistle? So likely around AD 60, 63, during his imprisonment in Rome. Most have it in that slot. Some even go as far as to pin down a little more and say 60 to 61. I think this is one of those that 60 to 63 is fine. Some may have it a little bit before, a little bit after. I think it was definitely, I think he makes reference to his imprisonment in the letter, like he does the others that he wrote during that time. And so I'm comfortable with that. So what is that? How does that have to do? What does the time matter? Well, it gives you a slot of understanding. You know, time with regards to when Christ died on the cross and was resurrected, how the church was progressing at that time, and some of the challenges, even at this age, that they were dealing with. We think about the challenges we face as a church or other churches like us and those that might even be listening to the churches they attend. But we understand that these things were already happening and the struggles were already, the adversary was already working, that devil, that Satan, he was already in the scene trying to stir up problems all the time. And so what it can do for us in understanding the time of this and putting it into this perspective, just as just one facet of things. You can always have a cup half full, cup half empty viewpoint. You can always choose a cup half full mindset. And you can say, okay, so they were having this problem. We were having problems similar. Paul was showing them how to get through it. He's showing us how to get through it. Let's anchor down in the Lord and press on. Some people get weary and they just want to walk away. That's not what these people were being taught to do. They were taught to press on. They were taught how to deal with the problem and move forward, getting back in play so that they can continue to do the work in that region that they needed to be doing. So it's not a call to abandon. It's a call to anchor and press, you know? So they were having challenges, and so this they are being addressed via this response, this spirit welling up in the apostle to want to engage in this for their sakes because of his love for them. And mind you, probable that he hadn't even met them in person, but just had heard about them. What was it about? What was the letter about? This is another one of the questions we want to know. Paul penned this letter to the Colossian church after he had received a report that they were struggling with extremely dangerous and threatening heresy. The report came from Epaphras, likely a leader of the church at Colossae, and a convert of Paul's from his more than two-year ministry in Ephesus. So Epaphras, I'm going to get into him a little bit more. Epaphras had come to Rome in part to serve Paul during his imprisonment, Philemon 123, but also to confide in him regarding the dangerous teachings the Colossians were hearing. So he had this twofold mission here. He's going to come in and try to help the Apostle Paul in Rome. Now, this verse I'm going to show you, when I have Philemon 123, it says this. It says, there salute thee, Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus. This passage of scripture leads some theologians to suggest, and again, it's possible, I suppose, that Epaphras was a prisoner with Paul in Rome. Although I don't really see that in the scriptures so much. I know when Paul was taken to Rome, he had appealed to Caesar in the book of Acts because the Jews were trying to kill him. And so he actually was arrested. He was brought before King Agrippa, almost persuaded King Agrippa to be saved. He was then put on a boat, and he went down a pretty hairy boat ride to get to Rome because he had appealed to Caesar. And as a Roman citizen, it was his right to be able to do that in a trial. And so that's what he was being ushered there for. And he did a lot of things on that journey that you can read about in the book of Acts. But anyway, I'm going off memory on that. So the details, if you want the full details, I encourage you to read the book of Acts, especially the parts that we're focusing in on here, which is the latter part. But I see a fellow prisoner in Christ as a different thing than a fellow prisoner in Rome. We can be fellow prisoners with Paul in Christ today by allowing ourselves to be yielded over to the direction and leadership of the Holy Spirit for our life, to literally give it's like saying, I yield my life to you, my God, to my Lord Jesus, to God the Father. I yield my life to you. Do with it as you will. Teach me what you want me to do. Give me the courage to do it. Lead me down the path you want me to go and give me the words to say. You know? That then if we completely yield wholly that way to God, then we do become fellow prisoners in Christ Jesus with the Apostle Paul and Epaphras. So I think what you really see here is just a man that was so moved to be a support for the apostle, one, because of his love for him, but also because of the work that he was doing. He was able to continue to work as a missionary in a lot of ways from prison in Rome. He was able to write these letters. They were able to carry them. They were able to do things. And so it's one of those things where I see him not as my conviction is that he wasn't imprisoned in Rome with Paul, but literally a fellow prisoner with Paul in Christ, which is something completely different. All right, here's that other picture I told you. This one's got a little bit better road on it. It looks very similar, and it may be another part of the other road, but this was one of the main streets in Colossae. And so, you know, you can almost see the life going on in it. You know, if you were to just let your imagination go a little bit and see the people moving up and down the street and whatnot, it's just interesting to see. Okay, so the church at Colossae was under attack from false teachers who were denigrating the deity of Jesus. They were attacking his deity and godliness. Though Paul had never been to the church itself, he addressed these issues head on. Now, I could have spent time going through a lot of those different forms of false teachings, but I think for the introduction, it would just weigh us down. I think we will get into it when it's time, when we get there in the scriptures, and we'll let it speak for itself then. So that's why you don't really see them listed out here. I just wanted to let you know, I hope you stay with the study, because we're going to get into that and we're going to have a little fun when we do. And yes, it will be intellectual. It will be in some cases, maybe a little deep, but we'll do our best to even that out a little bit, you know, to kind of soften it. Because the important thing is that we understand. And we could go deep to where we don't understand. What good does that do? So the important thing is we just understand. Okay, so Paul had never been to this church, but he addressed the issues head on. The nature of Jesus Christ as Creator and Redeemer was non-negotiable in Paul's mind, and rightly so. So Paul wrote to them that he might bring his wisdom to bear on this difficult and trying situation. Jesus Christ as Creator and Redeemer is not negotiable. When you allow it to be, you are in the wrong place, period. You are in a very dangerous place, period. Spiritually speaking, I say, spiritually speaking, in the Lord, Christ is the Creator, and Christ is the God-man, literally incarnate, God made flesh, okay? And that was necessary for him to suffer the payment of sin to please the government of God, whereby we could find forgiveness through his sacrifice. So he had to be an acceptable sacrifice. There was no good man save Jesus Christ or except Jesus Christ. And the reason he was good is because he was God-man. It's not negotiable. Anything else would have not pleased the government of God concerning the judgment upon sin. So, it's not negotiable. And he understood that. So he begins to use his wisdom to bear on the situation. It is critical to him that this church know God in his greatness and glory, rather than in the deficient view given them by the false teachers. And I don't have them out here because we're going to study them. But Colossians 1, 25 and 2, 1 and 2. Now, that brings us to the final component of the final rule, final question to begin this study. We know what the book, we know what who wrote it, to who he wrote it to. We know about when it was written, where he was at in relationship to writing it. We know what it was about. Now we want to know what the occasion is. In other words, what's it about and the occasion, the purpose and the occasion are kind of they're two different things, but they're very closely related. And it almost sounds like you're asking the same question, but you're really not. So what's it about is a great overall picture. The occasion has to do with what the intricacies were that were going on there that were being addressed. And so what was the occasion? To combat extremely threatening and dangerous heresies that was arising in the Colossae church, and to magnify the glories and accomplishments of God in Christ Jesus and exalt Christ to the glories justly and fitting due him. So that was the occasion. That was what he understood the problem. Now what he was trying to accomplish was to combat that problem. We know that there was a problem there. Now he's trying to combat it. And he's trying to magnify the glories and accomplishments of God in Christ Jesus and exalt Christ to those glories that were just and fitting for him to be exalted to, above all names, above everything that was ever created, above all principalities and powers. You know, to exalt him rightly for what he had accomplished in himself for our sakes, according to the will of his Holy Father. So there's the occasion. We're going to go on a little bit. In this book, the Apostle Paul describes Jesus with some of the loftiest language in all of the New Testament. And that's what I was getting into, some of that while I studied Ephesians, and my heart was getting, it was getting touched. It was welling up, and it was, the Spirit was crying out to me of the glories of Jesus Christ. My spirit was uplifted by the Spirit of God when I read about the glories here of Jesus Christ. And it caused me to think, the world needs to know this. People need to know. They need to be reminded of who our Savior is. So in this book, the Apostle Paul describes Jesus with some of the loftiest language in all the New Testament, focusing on Christ's preeminence and sufficiency in all things. I can't wait. Paul presented Christ as the center of the universe, not only as the active creator, but also as the recipient of creation in his taking on the human flesh. Christ was and is the visible image of the invisible God, containing within himself the fullness of deity. Colossians 2:9. I mean, those are powerful things right there. Wait till we get there. I hope you're with us when we get there. It's going to be fun. It's going to be fun. All right, so this is a picture of the theater at Hierapolis. And I thought that was awesome because it's still in pretty good shape, you know? So you can see even statues there if you can kind of focus in down there on the pedestal, on the platform. But it'd be an amazing thing to see something like that. That's old, you know? And who knows how many moments occurred in that theater. But anyways, I thought that was interesting. Because of his divine nature, Jesus is sovereign. Above all things, with authority given him by the Father. So sovereign is really above all. There's none other. He is above all. You know, this authority, you know, when we look at the book of Matthew, and when he's given the big commission that we all talk about, our commission as a church to go out into the world, Jesus says, "All power is given unto me in heaven and earth." And that's how it's read in the King James Version. That word is exousia in the Greek, and it means authority. And really what it's saying is all authority is given to me in heaven and earth. And it's not diminishing the power that is translated by King James translators to the word power. It's actually embracing the fullness of it. Because to be able to have authority is to have all power. If he has all authority of all things, he has all power over it. And so the point of it is that the authority is the key to all of it. And it's been given to him by the Father. Everything that is his, and he is sovereign over it. No one will challenge him. And if they do, they will not be effective at overcoming. That's our God. That's our Savior. As such, Jesus is also head over the church. Rightly so. He should be, and we should be yielded to him. He has reconciled all things to himself through his death on the cross, making believers alive to God and setting them on the path to right living. He has reconciled all things to himself through his death on the cross, making believers alive to God and setting them on the path to right living. And when I say death on the cross, of course, I'm talking about the whole act, the death, the burial, the resurrection, because they were all according to the plan of God. We're going to close out with these few things. The proper view of Christ served as an antidote for the Colossian heresy, as well as a building block for Christian life and doctrine, both then and now. Okay? It's an antidote to heresy. In fact, the heresy can't even stand if there was a shadow of it. Of course, the shadow would be the light of it. It couldn't even stand. You know, you go back to that arena. The heresy's not even in the arena. Okay, it's out there. You know, You know, it can't even compare to the lofty glories of Christ. And so that's the antidote that the Colossians needed for the heresy they were facing, to anchor them back. Christian life and doctrine are the building blocks. And so understanding who Christ is, he is the chief cornerstone, the stone which the builders disallowed. It became the head of the corner, you know, and I've talked about this before. I'm in construction. So there's always these spots on the building, and there's a point where everything else is going to be measured off of to start the construction. And the foundation is going to be made sure, or the building won't stand. And to do that, sometimes they got to drive piles into the ground, some 130 feet or more, to hit the rock. Jesus is that rock. He is that chief cornerstone from which everything else is laid out. Okay? So when we get the glorious view of Christ in this, then it's going to serve us to show us where we need to build our life and how we need to build it. Okay? What are the takeaways and general applications to what we talked about this morning? Your view of Jesus Christ will impact every area of your life. Many today want only practical instruction and helps for living, avoiding topics such as doctrine and theology because they seem to be out of touch with their day-to-day reality. And the contrary is true. Okay? Some people just want the practical instruction. They want something to say, this helps you feel good. Practical instruction. But doctrine and theology are what everybody that is a believer needs to get acquainted with and needs to get more of. They are not out of touch with day-to-day reality. They literally will help anchor your life in light of the day-to-day reality. Okay, so they are much needed. They're the building blocks of a good life. Paul's view is simple and practical, and this is it. Believers have died with Christ, therefore we need to die to our sins. That's one of the things we're going to learn. Those will be some of the takeaways. Also, we have also been raised with Christ, therefore we must live well in him and put on qualities that are motivated by Christian love. Okay? That's something else we'll come to understand. And because he is Lord over all, the life of the Christian is a life of submission to Jesus. That's another takeaway that will be learned. We are following after Jesus. In other words, are we following after Jesus as we should? That'll be a question that we should ask ourselves as we go through this study. Our faith in Jesus Christ should transform the relationships we have in every area of our lives, in our homes, our churches, and our world. And understand, you know, when we apply the scriptures, our homes are going to thrive. They're going to do better. When we apply the scriptures, our relationships are going to do better. Our churches are going to do better. Christ is the Lord over all things. We are redeemed by him and through his shed blood. Finally, we are not our own, but we are a blood-bought life and a blood-bought institution, the church. Okay? We are not our own. 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20. What? Know you not that your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and you are not your own? For you are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. We are bought with a price. So the things we do in this life with this vessel that God allows us to occupy, we need to strive to honor and glorify him because he paid a great price so that we could. And those perspectives will help us to do a better job in our efforts to do so. All right, we're going to close in a word of prayer. Loving Holy Father, we give you praise today for what you've provided for us in all areas of life, what you've provided for us in your written word, what you provided for us in your living word, what you provided for us in your indwelling Holy Spirit, what you give to us each and every day, the mercy you pour out upon us. I'm so ashamed sometimes. Your mercy's constant, and I see it, and I'm ashamed sometimes because of my shortcomings. that produces mercy from you. And Father, I pray that you'll just be with us all as we make a better effort to try to do a better job to live according to your will, to put out the desires of the flesh, and to just build our life on the foundation of Christ, striving to not only behave like him, but to try to do things that would praise him with the things we say and do, so that we might be a voice in this world, a light, and a vessel that you might use, or a tool, Lord, to do your work and your bidding. Please take our lives, Lord, use them as you will. Give us the strength to yield to you the reins of our lives, and help us to bring you honor and glory. We pray, Father, that you'll save souls today, that you'll change lives, ourselves included. We ask, Father, that you'll bless this lesson as we go through it, that you might give us the time to go through it appropriately and correctly, and give me the ability, Lord, to yield to your leadership and understanding. Pray, Father, that you'll forgive us of our sins and failures as we strive to forgive others. And we ask these favors and blessings now in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Thank you.
I can feel my